The other morning, I happened to be riding in my car, and I decided to go channel surfing to see what was on the airwaves. And I did what a lot of you may have done right now, and are centered in on this signal. Well, I heard a young man speaking over a religious station. He was a scientist, a biologist, and a nuclear energy consultant. I believe his name was Dr. Gary Parker. He was originally a secular humanist, but through research, he began to focus in on the creation. And he said, strangely enough, the thing that got me interested in creation was the woodpecker. And the more research I did on this marvelous bird, the more I realized the intricacy of creation. I welcome you to the program Night Sounds. My name is Bill Pearce, and I've decided to sort of go in that direction tonight and entitle my program in the form of a question: Can you prove it? Because that's often the set of words that people would address to a Christian or a creationist in saying, can you prove the existence of God? Well, it probably would take more than 30 minutes that we have at best here tonight, but it just got me interested in looking once again at the marvel of God's creation. Let's just back up way, way back to the beginning and reflect once again on His creation.
Let there be light. Let there be day. Let there be night. Good. Let there be heaven. Let there be earth. Good. Let there be dry land. Let there be water. Let there be plants and trees. Good. Let there be plants. Stars. Living creatures. From the water. In the air. On the land.
They were the beginning few moments of a dramatic portrayal of the creation that we did some years ago with some professional actors, and we went on to develop this dramatically through the creation of Adam and Eve, the temptation, the expulsion from the garden and on through to Cain and Abel. And tonight's program, with the title, Can You Prove It? How Do We Know That God Exists? Well, the presence of design in nature implies that there must be a creator, an energy force of great intelligence. Well, just looking around me in the studio tonight, perhaps specifically at this control board in front of me, if I were to lift up the cover on it, I would be met with a maze of circuitry and wires and chips and all sorts of unidentifiable, to me, parts of an electronic marvel. With the cover closed, I could say, well, there's nothing much going on under there. All I see on the top is a design. We have to explain how we think the complex world in which we live came into being. An explosion underneath this control board, or in an electronics factory, could in no way produce what the evolutionists would attest would be the way things happened. Just an indiscriminate big explosion? We need an explanation of some sort. The complex world in which we live is here. And again, chaos could not have issued forth order and complexity unless someone with purpose and intelligence caused it to. Again, as was suggested, we could put some dynamite under a pile of bricks and blow it up. The system contains sufficient energy and the correct building blocks to build the Taj Mahal, but is it really likely that blowing the bricks sky high would have that result? Even if we repeated the experiment millions of times, it's unlikely that it would ever result in the Taj Mahal or any other kind of building. Even though the building blocks and energy are there, more is needed. There must be a way for the energy to be channeled in the very precise way required to produce a very complex design. So that's exactly where we are tonight. And if someone says, can you prove it? I guess we could turn around and say, can you prove that it wasn't an intelligent designer behind all of this? And of course, tonight we're not given to arguments. This is an age-long discussion that has been held with greater minds, perhaps than you or I. But let's just allow the Spirit of the living God, as we believe in Him, to impress upon us the beauty of His creation. So many words have been written, not the least of which His holy word, and we heard part of it a moment ago in dramatic form, in the beginning. Not an explosion, not some indiscriminate energy source coming from something crawling up out of the slime as a one-celled creature. So many, I guess we could say, ludicrous explanations have been made. But let's ask for truth from the God of all creation, Himself, as we take up the Holy Word of God and open to Genesis chapter 1 and read these fantastic words, in the beginning, God. The Holy Spirit can impart truth at a moment's notice. Well, let's just imagine that you and I wake up tomorrow morning and see the sun streaming through the windows. We might ask the question, how did this happen? It's right on time.
Sunrise in the morning, let all creation greet the dawn and praise the Lord.
the artist, he praised the divine artist. Whatever he found in the things made, he referred to the Maker. He rejoiced in all the works of the hands of the Lord, and in beautiful things he saw divine beauty itself. Whoever is not enlightened by such brilliance of things created must be blind. Whoever is not awakened by their mighty voice must be deaf. And whoever fails to praise God for all his works must be voiceless.
For all of us would be blind. If not for the light of our Lord.
The voice of John Michael Talbot. His song, The Creation. Let's listen further now as he looks into the heavens at the marvelous constellations, the arrangements of heavenly bodies, and considers God's beautiful creation.
He who created
and who strives the height of creation. He is the Lord, the God of hosts by name.
John Michael Talbot and Company, The Creation and the Constellations. You're in tune with Night Sounds. I'm Bill Pearce, and our subject tonight, in the form of a question, can you prove it? Anytime someone would just say that sentence in question, you could almost guess that he or she is asking, does God really exist? And that's the subject of our program tonight. And as I mentioned a moment or two ago, we would not be able to comprehensively get into this and, I guess, prove to everyone listening that yes, he does exist. Not only exists, he has created you and me, and the fact and privilege of our meeting together in this manner tonight. He has given man the absolutely incredible ability to create things on his own, using what God has already created to build support systems and cities and machines and all sorts of wonderful marvels we see around us. It's interesting to note that so many would disregard God in favor of something that really, in comparison, wouldn't even be mentionable. The theistic truth that God exists and has done all this connects with our reason. It's in the Bible, God's holy word, that has been preserved. And that alone is a marvelous pursuit if we want to look into that. The way his word has been preserved through the centuries, given through human beings, the accuracy of it, on target. And it's in this book that we discover further compelling evidence that not only theism, but Christianity is, at the least, deserving of our fullest investigation. I can't come up with all of the answers, of course, but as we ask for truth and for wisdom, God has promised to give it. If we take a few moments to read the first chapter of the book of James in the New Testament, we'll see right down around verses 5 or 6, he says, if any man, any woman, boy or girl, lacks wisdom, let him, her, ask of God, who gives to all liberally and does not withhold. We may not get that wisdom and answer in a few seconds' time, but he will lead us into truth. Good many years ago, a musical was written by Kurt Kaiser, Ralph Carmichael. Tell It Like It Is was the title of this musical. And contained in that entire structure was a song entitled Master Designer. Whoever, wherever you are, make yourself known to me. The quest of a young person whose mind is beginning to wonder about the marvels that he or she would see around them. Well, I took trombone in hand with the Stockholm Symphony string section and some woodwinds in the background. Kurt Kaiser is expert arranging, and we played the theme to this particular arrangement, Master Designer. Wherever you are, communicate. And he has done this through Jesus Christ, who came to identify with you and me, with all humankind, and lead us into truth, as he said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to God except by me. Let's consider that and the wonderful possibilities personally as we play once again.
Thank you.
The song played on trombone with a string orchestra, Master Designer. You're in tune with Night Sounds. I'm Bill Pearce, with you by radio. What a beautiful privilege I count this to get with you again and meet under these particular conditions. Thank you for listening. Night Sounds comes on the air basically five nights a week, Monday through Friday. And I'd love to communicate with you beyond this point as we go off the air in a few moments through compact discs, the music of Night Sounds, some of which you hear in the background. If you'd like a catalog that gives an overview of the entire procedure here, our mailing address is Night Sounds, Wheaton, Illinois, 60189. And the title of tonight's program is, in the form of a question, Can You Prove It? And we're discussing the existence of our God. Pretty big subject for a few minutes late at night, isn't it? There was an excellent article, incidentally, in a recent edition of Discipleship Journal by Dennis McCullum, part of which we're quoting tonight. He said, evidence is accumulating that the universe is finite. This finding leads to a powerful argument for the existence of God. Scientists are now virtually unanimous in saying that the universe is expanding. The movement of stars and galaxies away from each other can be measured. And if all these galaxies are moving away from each other, this could not have gone on for an infinite period of time. And if we reason backward in time far enough, the stars and other matter in the universe must, at one time, have been together in one place. This is, in fact, what science teaches. At some point in time, the so-called Big Bang theory occurred, which sent the stars and galaxies hurtling out from one another, as they still are tonight. So many questions have been unanswered, and we're still discovering. That's wonderful, that as we look at the stars moving in their orbits, they do move and they're right on time. But probably we never considered that they're moving outward. Things are moving all the time because God is a God of action. He's not benign. He's not unconcerned or indifferent. He's not only interested, he's in action. And he has provided for you and me for eternity because he's placed it in our hearts as we were created in his image. This is too much for me to handle, and I'm sure for anyone with greater knowledge and experience and intelligence than I, but let's just have touched on it and leave it there for you to consider. And since God has acted in our behalf, we really can't be neutral toward him because, well, basically he was not neutral toward us. And that makes a big difference. Again, that's why Jesus came and says to us tonight through the Gospel of Matthew, come to me, all of you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. And I'll tell you, if there's anything we need tonight, it's rest and peace in our inner beings. As we look at the surface hostilities and everything that's happening around us, we need stability. We need someone. We need God. Thank you for allowing these moments together. Be delighted to hear from you. Our mailing address remains Night Sounds, Wheaton, Illinois, 60189. If we can stand with you in your prayer concerns, we want to do this. Just a few hours ago, we activated our prayer group, praying for you. Let us hear from you. Until next time, may the God of creation be near you. God bless you, and good night to all of you.